Hello everyone. Now, in the last session of satellite communication and networking, we have completed our third unit, that was the geostationary unit, right? Geostationary orbit. Now we are going to start with the next unit, that is unit number 6, which is called as space segment. Right, and today is total lecture number 11, which has an introduction and a power supply. Topics to be covered in this following session are: first, introduction; second, power supply; and third, attitude and orbit control. Now, as we have studied that what types of orbits, and in that in unit 3 we have studied the geostationary orbit in detail. Right, now in the unit 6, from the unit 6 it is going to divide into a two segments, right? As we have discussed in the introductory session, that satellite communication is divided into two segments. In first segment, that is which is in space, which is called a space segment, and second, that is the earth segment. Here, which is the earth station antennas and telemetry command and system, monitoring system, which was observed, which can be observed satellite from the orbit. Clear? So in this unit 6, we are going to discuss each and every portion or each and every topic related to the space sector. Then what are the different parts for that the satellite needed to be carried out when it is launched. Right? Now, going with the first, that is introduction. So, a satellite communication can broadly divided into two segments: a ground segment and a space segment. Right. So, as I have said, that a whole satellite communication system has been divided into two segments. First, that is ground segment, in which earth station antennas and all that are considered, and second, that is the space segment, in which we considered our satellite. Clear? The space segment will obviously includes the satellites, but it also includes the ground facilities needed to keep the satellite operational, that being referred to as telemetry, tracking and command system, that is TTC and M facilities, right? So the in TTC facilities, half part is included in satellite for operational to track the motion of satellite operational, and half part of TTC and M has been implemented on the earth station for controlling that. Okay? So the apart from the satellite, it also includes the TTC and M facility. In many networks, it is common practice to employ a ground station solely for the purpose of TTC and M. Right. So further depends on which kind of satellites we are including. For that particular some point, if there is no let's say if there is a satellite in geostationary, so there is no need of TTC and M, right? Because we can observe from the earth itself, and it is a stationary with respect to point of home. Yeah, so it is not required, right, for the geostationary satellite in which TTC and M is considered. So only the ground station part will be appeared at the TTC and M part. Now, as shown in figure, the communication takes place between the space segment subsystems and earth segment subsystems through this communication link. Right? Now, as you can see in this figure, this is the space segment subsystem, which contains the satellite and its various portions. And here is this earth segment, in which there are earth station antennas with connected with the various blocks. Right? And these both segments will connect with the communication link, that is nothing but our free space transmission. Now, what does the space segment subsystem means? The subsystem present in space segment are called as space segment subsystem. Following are the space segment subsystems. First, that is AOC, that is attitude and orbit control subsystem, through which the satellite is observed that it maintain its position, that is attitude, and if it is in its correct orbit or not, that is orbit control, right? So both can be done with the AOC subsystem, that is attitude and orbit control system. Then TTC and M, that is telemetry, tracking, command and monitoring subsystem. Right, in which TTC part will be in the space segment, where M, that is monitoring part, will be in the earth segment. then the satellite will also include power and antenna subsystem. It will carry out its batteries, right, to work during the eclipse period, right, and antenna for communication purpose. And last, that is transponders. So transponders, what it will do? So it will receive that particular signal, pre-process that particular signal, and it will again retransmit to the earth station. Clear? So these are the four various most important parts in which the space segment subsystems are divided. Now, the equipment carried abroad the satellite can also be classified according to the function. How it is classified? So it is classified according to the function, in which first that is known as payload. So the payload refers to the equipment used to provide the service for which the satellite has to be launched. So whenever there will be an external launching, right, through GSLV or PSLV, then GSLV and PSLV, they are called as payloads, on which the satellite need to be implemented, and whenever it is launched, the whole payload comes back to the earth station. In the communication satellite, the equipment which provides the connecting link between the satellite transmit and receive antenna is referred to as transponders. Right, so here the definition of transponders has been discussed. That is, what does the transponders do? It will receive that particular antenna signal, then it will pre-process that signal, and then again retransmit through the transmitting satellite antennas. Right, the transponders form one of the main sections of the payload, the other being the antenna subsystem. So there are the two main sections of the payload. First, that is transponder, in which the pre-processing occurs, and second, for communication, that is antenna subsystem. Now each we will carry it out in detail. In today's session we will discuss about power supply and attitude and control system. Now next, going with the second topic, that is the power supply. The primary electrical power for operating the electronic equipment is obtained from solar cells. Individual cells can generate only small amounts of power, and therefore arrays of cells in series and parallel connections are required. So the most important, first of all, factor in satellite communication, that is your solar panels. So each and every satellite which we design will have a solar panels, in which there are number of solar cells in what we called as array of cells, right, in series and parallel connection are connected, right, and with the help of that solar panels, due to sun rays, that solar due to solar power, the operation of a satellite in space carried out. Figure shows the solar cell panels of HS 376 satellite manufactured by UJ Space and Communication Company. Right, in the next slide we will see a graph, right, of the solar panels of this particular satellite, which is HS 376. In geostationary orbit, the telescoped panel is fully extended, that both are exposed to sunlight, right? So this solar panels are first exposed to the sunlight, and at the beginning of the life, the panel produced 940 watt DC power, which may drop to 760 watt at the end of 10 years. As we know that the lifespan of geostationary orbit, that is 10 to 15 years. Now, during eclipse, power is provided by two nickel cadmium, that is NICD, long life batteries, which will deliver 830 watt power. Right, and at the end of life, battery recharge time is less than 16 hours. Now, as you can see in this figure, right, in this figure, it is the figure which we have discussed in the previous slide, that the solar panels figure, right, in which of that particular satellite HS 376. Here it is on the y-axis, it is shown as eclipse time, and here it is the day of the year. Right now, as you can see, from the 16th day to 100 day, it is showing as a full shadow. Clear? Right, and it is a half shadow. Right, so during this period there will be a satellite eclipse from 110 to 240. सैटेलाइट एक्लिप्स टाइम एज अ फंक्शन ऑफ करंट डे ऑफ द ईयर राइट सो ईच एंड एवरी डे विल हैव एटलीस्ट एक्लिप्स टाइम ऑफ अ समवॉट टाइम राइट एंड दिस टाइम हैज बीन शोन इन दिस फिगर नाउ नेक्स्ट दैट इज एटीट्यूड एंड ऑर्बिट कंट्रोल इन दिस वी विल स्टडी अबाउट एटीट्यूड कंट्रोल एंड द ऑर्बिट कंट्रोल वी विल सी इन द नेक्स्ट सेशन The attitude of the satellite refers to its orientation in space. So the attitude shows us the at which position the satellite needs to be launched, right? That is orientation in space. Much of the equipment carried aboard a satellite is that the purpose of controlling its attitude, right? That means to maintain its position right from the Earth surface, that is called as attitude control. Attitude control is necessary, for example, to ensure that directional antennas point out in proper direction. So why it is attitude control is necessary? So that the Earth station antenna and the satellite antenna will point towards each other. So there will be a no misalignment loss in between them. In case of Earth environmental satellites, the Earth sensing instruments must cover the required region of the Earth, which also requires attitude control, right? So whenever there will be a Earth environmental satellite, what we need is a Earth sensing instrument, which covers the region of Earth, right? And at a particular, at which height that particular satellite should need to be launched so that the required regions are the must be covered. So that is done with the help of attitude control. A number of forces referred to as disturbances stop can alter the altitude, for example, which we have seen in orbital perturbations, that is gravitational field of Earth and Moon, solar radiation and meteorite impact. So these are the some examples due to which the altitude of the satellite changes. Attitude control must not be confused with station keeping, which is term used for maintaining a satellite in its correct orbital position. So the station keeping is used for the to maintain the correct position in the orbit, right? Whereas attitude control, that is nothing but in at particular this time at which position the satellite is there or at which height so that it can covers the region, right? And although they two are closely related. To exercise attitude control, there must be available measure of satellite orientation in space and of any tendency for this to shift. And for this, in one method, infrared sensors referred to as horizon detectors are used to detect the rim of the Earth against the background of the space. With the use of four such sensors, one on each quadrant, the center of Earth can be readily established as a reference point. Usually, the attitude control process takes place aboard the satellite, but it is also possible for control signals to be transmitted from Earth based on attitude data obtained from the satellite, right? So at which point we need to transmit that particular signal that will be get from the attitude control data. Also, where a shift in attitude is desired, an attitude maneuver, which is called as attitude observer, is executed. What it will do, this control signal need to achieve this maneuver may be transmitted from an Earth station. Now, controlling torques may be generated in a number of ways. Passive attitude control refers to the use of mechanism which stabilize the satellite without putting a drain on the satellite energy supplies. At most, infrequent use is made of these supplies. For example, when thruster jets are impulsed to provide corrective torque. That means if the satellite is not in a correct position at attitude control, so what we need to do is we need to apply the thruster jets which provide the correct torque and will maintain its attitude from that position. Examples of passive attitude control are spin stabilization and gravity gradient stabilization. Right? These both methods we will discuss in the next session. The other form of attitude control, that is active control. With active attitude control, there is no overall stabilization torque present to resist the disturbance torque. Instead, corrective torques are applied as a required response to disturbance torque. Methods used for to generate active control torques include momentum wheel, electromagnetic coils, and mass explosion device such as gas jets and ion thrusters. So in this attitude control, there are basically two methods, that is passive control and active control. In passive control, the example of passive control, that is our spin stabilization method, which we are going to see in the next session, right? And in the second form, that is active control, in which it is called as momentum wheel stabilization, which we will also see in the next session. The three axes which defines this attitude control are roll, pitch, and yaw, which is denoted by R, P, and Y. These axes are related to earth, which shown in figure 2, which we will see in the next thing. Now, see in this figure, what you can see is, this is the earth center. This is the earth center, right? And this is the satellite which is orbiting in its position, right? So through the earth center to the center of the satellite, that is called as yaw axis, right? Whenever the satellite is moving in the perpendicular to orbital plane, that is called as pitch axis, right? And the orbit through which the tangential to that particular axis, that is called as roll axis, right? All three axes passes through the center of gravity of the satellite. For an equatorial orbit, movement of a satellite about the roll axis moves the antenna footprint north and south. Movement about the pitch axis moves the footprint to the east and west. Pitch, that is perpendicular to the orbital plane. So it will move through the east and west, right? Roll will move to the north and south with its tangential direction. And movement about the yaw axis rotates the antenna footprint. So that's all for today's session. In the next session, we will going to discuss the two methods of attitude control, that is spin stabilization and momentum wheel stabilization, and we'll also discuss about the orbit control and its station keeping. So thank you.